You know, I wrote a book called In the Violent Take It by Force. And this is just an excerpt from it on page 7. It says, the military studies the enemy by the use of spies to get inside information to befriend the enemy under false pretenses to gain trust in order to get the upper hand. This is called enemy infiltration. It's having the ability to disguise oneself and be able to blend in and act accordingly to gain information to report to the commanding post. So, you know, Satan is known by a lot of names. And, well, I'm not going to even go into the names. But anytime you have opposing enemies, there's always a hierarchy that they operate by. God has a hierarchy, but we're going to talk about the hierarchy of Satan, okay? So Satan has a kingdom. His hierarchy is established, and every kingdom must have commanding officers to whom each rank must report to perform effectively. So hierarchy is defined as a ruling body that is organized into orders or ranks, each subordinate to the one above it. So Ephesians 12 tells us what? We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, and spiritual wickedness in high places. So this is how Satan operates. He's the top dog, okay? He's the prince of the power of the air, and below him is the spirit called Beelzebub, which is the prince of the devils that answers only to Satan, like the Holy Spirit answers only to God. Then there's the principalities. Principality means chief or prince. And they are positioned at the four corners of the earth, over cities, over states, over countries and nations. They are known as archangels, meaning that they're first in order or first in rank. Then you have the powers. Now, these are the rulers of organizations, known as exousia spirits. They have special abilities and are highly competent. Okay, now when I say that they're rulers of organizations, I'm going to use examples. Masons, Illuminati, these type of things. That's who they're rulers of.
Mm-hmm.
And when what they do, now these power spirits, if lower-ranking demons are assigned to carry out an assignment and they fail at it, the powers come in and they exercise their special abilities and they actually go in for the kill. And it's almost like the CIA of the government, or it's like the Navy SEALs of our government. You know, they're the ones that have special abilities. Then we have the ruler spirits, and they rule over families and individuals and neighborhoods. They're known as cosmocrators. And cosmocrators meaning that they're world rulers and have direct contact with targets. These are also the spirits that are antichrist spirits that draw people from Christ. Now, cosmocrator comes from the word, we get the word cosmetics from the word cosmocrator. And what it does is that it hides things. It puts makeup on it. It covers it so that you can't tell the true identity of it. Then we have the spiritual wickedness in high places, and these are evil spirits that cause malice and iniquity. They even cause illness and poverty, diseases, depression, sin, and idolatrous activities. So here's the thing. We in the body of Christ, and I'm not trying to beat down the church or anything, but we're so far behind because we're going in looking for a happy message to make us happy. Yet still, when we go home, some of us want to blow our brains out. We want to kill the family. We want to divorce. We want to hurt each other. You know, there's so much malice even in the church. But when the enemy knows that there is division, he has an upper hand. You know, he comes in real easily. So Satan, you know, we know that he was cast in the third heaven, right? We know that he took one-third of the angels with him. But he didn't accomplish his conniving ways after he departed. See, this was all communicated and set in place before he was even excommunicated from the presence of God. So he was so convincing and alluring that he caused one-third of the angelic host to become excommunicated with him. But God is not ignorant, okay? He's omnipotent, all-knowing, all-powerful, all-seeing. And so even though he recognized that, God is so awesome, so off the chain, and so majestic and so strategic, he even gave Satan a place to reside while he does everything that he wanted to do. So Satan thinks, you know, Satan's nature is deception. But he he is so deceptive that he deceived himself. So I believe he thought his plans were hidden from God. And this is what sin does. It separates us from God, and it makes us start thinking opposite of God. So one thing about it is that God showed me years ago about our prayers, and he was saying that it goes through a brazen heaven. And, yes. And the example he gave me was when Daniel had prayed for 21 days, and the angel had appeared to him and told him, hey, Daniel, we heard your prayers, man. They're going up. However, it's not that we weren't ignoring you, but we had some interference going on. So the angel was delayed because he had to fight with the prince of Persia, and the war was so intense that he had to call for backup from Michael, the chief angel. So what we're saying here is that when we're praying, and when we're praying these watered-down prayers and asking God to come by and see us and visit us and you know our situation, God, these are prayers that's just hitting the sky and falling back down. They're not penetrating prayers. So our prayers can't be weak. It can't be water. They have to be intense. They have to be fiery, and they have to be destructive. So we're supposed to bombard the heavens to cause total destruction of second heaven activity. Our mindset should be to cauterize and to annihilate. Cauterize means to deaden and to make insensible. Annihilate means to cause to be of no effect, to regard as no consequence, and to cause to cease to exist. In other words, we're supposed to utterly destroy the works and diabolical plans of the enemy by the power of the word that comes from our mouth. But we have to be in position. We have to be in place in order to execute that. So we have to know who we are, and we have to understand our kingdom positions. God said that he has seated us in heavenly places. Okay, and we have to know our given kingdom authority, having the ability to operate as a king and a priest. So 1 Peter 2 and 9 says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and a holy nation, a peculiar people. Then Luke 9 turned around and says, then he called his 12 disciples together, and he gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. But here's the thing. A lot of Christians don't believe that we should even operate from that realm. A lot believe that we can just pray a prayer, ask God to heal, and that is it. So I'm like this. What good is it to have power and authority if you don't have dominion? You know, there's a difference between position and posture. Position is official placement, but posture is a state, a condition, or an attitude. So I have to ask the body of Christ, which one are we? You know, where are we standing? Because it does no good for a person to die, to leave an inheritance. You go and go to the reading of the will. You are appointed or are given inheritance. But if you don't receive it and use it, what good is it? You know, you can have it, but if you don't operate in it, it's nothing. But when you're talking about warfare, you know, as in anything, you have to understand the language of it, you know, because if you don't understand the language, then you can get lost. And this is where, unfortunately, a lot in the body of Christ are lost at. You know, I mean, Jesus went about teaching and preaching. He went about healing. He went about casting out devils. He went about establishing the kingdom. All of this falls in alignment with the kingdom. So, you know, Jesus said that deliverance is the children's bread. So why is it that so many of us in the church are being held captive by the enemy? We're supposed to be the ones to walk in authority. We're supposed to be the ones to walk in power and dominion. So our mindset should be that of a warrior, because we're in a war every day. By the grace of God, we don't have to contend with every fight, because God has dispatched angels to fight battles. What about some of those battles that we, you know, we still encounter that we could have released from our mouth on a daily basis, exercising our authority? God, I decree that, you know, I ask that you dispatch the angels to go before me and make my ways prosperous and with peace. I would have the mind of Christ in every assignment that has been assigned against me in my sleeping hours that the enemy has to devise. I'll annihilate it today and decree that it has no power. I walk in dominion. I walk in power. I walk in authority. I tread upon the enemy this day. Know what the form is able to prosper. I serve the devil. Notice today that he is being evicted from my life. You know, we have to change the way we pray. You know, and it's not just mere words or just reciting. It's knowing it and walking in that authority.
Yes.
I'm going to shift a little bit because, see, all of this is falling up under warfare, like witchcraft and the occult. So a lot of times I hear the church say, oh, witchcraft ain't real. It only affects you if you allow it to. Well, you know, we're ignorant sometimes. So is witchcraft real and does it really work? Well, the Bible tells us in Exodus 22 and 18, suffer a witch not to live. This was Old Testament, but it's many new references in the New Testament concerning witchcraft and occults as well. So witchcraft is defined as the use of sorcery or magic, communication with the devil or familiar spirits, and the use of supernatural powers outside of God and not submitting to God. Another definition is wanting to be what I call a spiritual mover and shaker without submitting to God. So 1 Samuel states that for rebellion is as a sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. And it's because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected thee from being king. Of course, we know he was talking to Saul. Saul did some stuff. He opened up some doors. He released a decree, but he went against that decree. But because of his own fleshly desires, he opened up something. He became obedient. Micah 5 and 12 states that, and I will cut off witchcraft out of thine hand, and thou shalt have no more soothsayer. So what I'm saying here is that witchcraft begins with rebellion and a dirty heart. Not necessarily wanting somebody working something. It manifests through the flesh. You don't have to be a witch. You don't have to be a warlock to operate in witchcraft. So believe it or not, Christians operate in witchcraft when they're in rebellion to God and disobedient to him. Unfortunately, the church is blind to a lot of things. Witchcraft is so powerful in the church.
My God.
It's very powerful in the church. From the pulpit to the back door.
My.
And I praise is shifting the atmosphere till the heavens are open. This praise is shifting.